Hello, Narnach here. Welcome back to Path of Exile. We have reached cruel difficulty and we are now in the coast on our way to the prison. It is patch 2.3.3 and it includes an experimental new feature. That is multi-threaded rendering, which is pretty nice if you got a modern CPU that has multiple cores on it, and these days all computers have that. The game uses quite a bit of CPU power to render what's on the screen, especially if there are more than one mob around. Now your CPU might be taxed to the limit. Let's see, nothing truly terrible here. So, But the game uses multiple, you got multiple cores in your computer, and most of the time one of them is doing most of the heavy lifting and the other ones are being pretty bored. The multi-threaded rendering, that's now as an experimental feature that you have to go out of your way to enable, now changes it so that it will use all the cores available, and you'll most notably notice that in areas where there's a lot of stuff happening. So imagine a screen full of monsters, lots of ground effects, lots of particle effects, lots of things going on. In that case, the additional cores in your computer will jump in to help render it. The patch notes, so if you open the game, it patches itself. In the patch note, it says how to enable it. So if you are into trying that, and especially if you have a multi-core system and performance has been an issue for you, especially in the more busy scenes, might be useful. I played around with it for about 5 minutes prior to starting this recording. Just I quickly ran through the docs back in normal difficulty just to see if it was completely broken or not. And after that I did a run through Camp Path, because there's a lot of fire effects going on, and it's graphically a rather intense area. It was the very first thing that popped in my mind as how can I stress test this for a little bit. And so it performed beautifully. If I run with uncapped frame rate, then it's just gonna go completely off the charge. Even while I was recording, because of course I'm mostly interested in the performance while recording the game. Even while recording, most of the time it was just humming along at like 120 frames, and I only recorded 60, so that's very nice. And even in the most complicated scenes I've encountered, I didn't see the frame rate drop below 70, so that's still way more than what I need in order to make it buttery smooth on your screen. So yeah, I'm happy that this feature is now in. So it's added as an experimental feature in 2.3.3. That way the community can give their feedback, which I probably should do after I finish recording this, just to give a heads up, like, hey, it's working for me. Or not if I encounter something, but so far so good. And in 2.4, the next major update, which will probably just coincide with the next expansion or whatever the devs have planned, then it will become a standard feature. So if you're not going to live on the edge, if you currently don't have any performance issues, if you're playing hardcore characters and you don't want to take the risk, just keep the experimental feature off, and your life is going to be exactly the same as it used to be. So that basically was just what I wanted to say about that. We have managed to make it all the way over here already. Just playing on autopilot mostly, just focused on tame things, but we are so immensely powerful. It's a couple of days since I last played this build. Since I record like 2 or 3 episodes in a row. And because I'm multitasking this with my shadow, the frost shadow, I think it's been like 4 or 5 days since I last played this, but I forgot just how fun and powerful this build is. Really, really curious to see just how far we can push this in the endgame. It's nice that I've got multiple endgame characters that I'm just running maps on and just experiencing that part of the game with. and especially, most importantly, just figuring out where all the pitfalls are, because there's a lot of dangerous things in the maps. Bosses that are just completely insane. Things like, yeah, Izaro on Merciless is a pretty tough bugger. You don't want to do him on level 65. Well, things like that. So, learning with my other characters, so when it gets to it, we'll push this as far as we can. So, prophecy triggered in a fire from the sky. So this is a burning tempests. They give you flammability if you stand in them. That's really a good idea. At least, yeah, my mana flask was the one that fixed my curses. It's always useful to have something that removes curses. So we are now, of course, looking for the way out. Alternatively, the Dweller in the Deep. My goal for this episode is to kill the Warden, just to make it to the prison. So I believe in terms of trials, on Cruel, we can still skip everything. Because we did them all on the previous character. And then on Merciless, we actually have to start doing trials again. I don't know, what do you think about trials? Do you even care about them? Do you want to see them? Or are you, well, fine with me skipping the trials and then just doing them in between episodes or things like that? Because most of the time, well, if I encounter a trial, sure, fine, whatever, we'll do them. If we need to. But if you've already done a trial, then there's really no point. But on Merciless, where I still have to do them. Yeah, is it something that you really care about, seeing just how I make it through the trials? Or just like, yeah, no, it's not really all that interesting anymore, and I'm glad that we can skip it, so please just skip the trials where possible. Okay, so level up, skill point. So last time we grabbed gratuitous violence, bleeding enemies will explode. We still need to apply more bleeding. So last time we grabbed this one and we were on our way to get bloodless. So that's exactly what we do. Just gonna pump up our life. So this is the bridge, that's the way out. That means we'll be skipping the Dweller in the Deep, because he'll be on the other side somewhere. And in between episodes, I'll go back and kill the Dweller in the Deep. I didn't even remember to put down the totem. Hello there. What's the level? 41. I mean, I'm 45 right now. So I am overleveled for the area. Top of that, this turns out to be a pretty darn powerful build in terms of damage output. I mean, we're doing 1500 DPS exactly. Oh, 1505. I'm rounding that to 1500 DPS. But we got 94 now, mana per second, or life per second that we are regenerating. That's just virtue of the golem and some passive life regen that we picked up from the skill tree. We have evasion, we have a two-handed block, we have maxed out resists with the exception of chaos, which is something we will need to start paying more attention to now. And we have a ton of lifesteal and life per hit and all those good things just on top of everything. So even if we do take damage, which will be mitigated of course because we got armor and things like that, then we have the lifesteal on top of everything to get things back. So sustained damage we should be able to handle very, very well. It's gonna be the spike damage that will kill us eventually. Yeah, we also have Fortify. Look at this. This is just completely unfair for all these poor, poor mobs. So defenses, we will fix it at some point once we switch out of a tabula to something that's a bit more sturdy. Yeah, let's make a quick town stop. Once we get into something a bit more sturdy, we'll boost our armor, we'll boost our evasion, we'll boost everything. Let's pick up these steel skill. So let's see. All the chromatic items, chromatic. And were they actually useful? No, this is worse than what we had. So we can just skip it. And everything else is just meh. We'll keep this here because currency will stack. Did we fulfill a prophecy? Yes, so we will seek out a new one. Path of Betrayal. There will be Kurubi's spirits now weathered carvings. And we'll send them back to Hinakura. We can do that. We can do that. Right, that's... Oh, that's cool. Okay. We came from there. Yeah. So we need to go to the other way.
My spirit is spent.
Spent harder. Hey, Vegan, buddy. How are you doing today? Oi, no cheating. You're running away. Okay, that was... Undying Shade, this is the Plague Maw prophecy setting in. Oh, there's another one behind all the loot. Wormbone. That sounds like it's reasonably advanced. What's the level on Wormbone? Level 37. Oh, yeah, we've got small swords that inflict bleeding, so nice, but don't really care. So many optional quests. We'll fix them slowly. But the thing is, the interesting thing is that our overkill causes an explosion, which is just going to be the overkill damage that sets things on fire. That's because of Herald of Ash. And on top of that, bleeding enemies will explode for 10% of their max life. And the more reliably we inflict bleeding, the more often even trash mobs are going to explode. So the larger packs are, the more vulnerable they will be for all those AoE effects that are going on. And one interesting part of the explosion damage scaling with monster life is that it scales with monster life. So the further we get into the game, well, if you kill the first couple of mobs, they will do damage that scales along with the enemy. So even if we are maxed out on skills and we are not getting better weapons, the fact that some of our damage just scales with the life of opposing minions means our damage will keep going up. Even though we might have to put a little bit more effort into getting that first kill done. Okay. Hello there, goodies. So many skills that are now ready for leveling. Okay. Got a feeling we should be more or less there. Ooh, a hex font. They're always funny, random curses. Just after the encounter, just drink from your curse removal flask to get rid of the remaining curse, but during the fight with the hex font, don't even bother unless you got something that will keep the immunity up for a while. In my case, mana flask helps a little bit. Kurubi spirits at weather carvings. I think there's one next to the lionized swords, isn't there? Got a waypoint, that's important. Actually pick up the thing. Okay, that's the dead end. That means we are going east. Or to the right side of the map. It's also funny how for a character that only uses life, I got quite an amount of energy shield going on that is staying up a pretty good portion of the time. I was initially surprised by that. Oh, come on, stop ch- chasing after my golem that's 2 screens behind. Also, golem, catch up, please. Ready. Aha! Curry spirits. Proper challenge. Okay. End of proper challenge. And that was them. Didn't have a quest for that remaining. Hello there. So there's another prophecy here next to a lionized standard that will animate all kinds of swords around it. So it's funny that this... Oh wait, of course, Path of Betrayal is just any stone. It's not specific to this area. The other one is Gladiator Helmet. That's a nice amount of armor. Not a pure armor character, but if I were, that would have been a nice find. And a bunch of blues, and there is Iron Points. Who is a lot easier here than in his map version. He's a pretty tough bugger in the maps. Well, that's also because he does a ton of chaos damage then, and here... If he does chaos damage, you never really notice. So once I'm gonna get a bit more serious into crafting on cruel difficulty, I'll make sure to get my chaos resistance to... I don't know, trying to at least get it positive, but... My goal is gonna be to get it to at least 50% or something. To really put in a bit of effort to get chaos resistance. So if we encounter chaos resistance, which doesn't really start happening properly until late Merciless. It's Act 4 Merciless, that's where chaos is a pretty big issue. Until then, not really. Let's make a really brief town stop. Then we're gonna go for the border. So let's see, another chromatic. Everything else is just random rares. Energy shield, warhammers, and... Oh wait, this was the... We already had a better sword. Oh, let's pick up a new prophecy. The corrupt. So that's gonna require a Vaal side area. Hidden Vaal pathways. That's another Vaal side area. That's pretty cool. Nessa, what are you gonna get me? Reduce mana, weapon and mental damage, physical projectile, mana leech, and that fire. Let's take that one for now. Not really care. And let's just empty our pockets just because we're here. And we put everything into the sorting bucket. And then we continue looking for the warden. Looking for warden. If we do happen to encounter the trial, I am gonna just... I think, could you... No, wait, you can't click the stone because it's inside. That's annoying. In the maps, they did a proper job by showing you the stone of completion. Or is that the monograph that I can click? Can I click it? No. Right, so, I know I got a character pretty far. Not just as far. Well, I'll check it in Act 3 then. In maps, you have the tablet that shows you how far you are. It always listed at the beginning. Oh wow, chatter says ghost possessed. That means we'll put up a totem. And that wasn't even necessary. But it is nice that you can see before you enter the trial if you actually need to do it or not. Especially now that you only need to do it once per league per difficulty level. Rather than for every character. Shoulder harp, nice. Let's see, 42 area, so we're still a couple levels ahead. Okay, so there's a lot of stuff going on here. The frame rate is still at 60. Normally, all this lightning effects going on, that would be pretty bad for the frame rate. No, the lightning, the frost, those effects, they tended to be really, really nasty. Now, things are just humming along just fine. Let's see you, Soul Eater. Nice. Just exploding everything. And there is the door to the next one, to the upper prison. You will defeat a very powerful invading monster. Hello there, apparition. I'll kill you twice. Fagan, buddy! Again! Okay. If you just stand still there and look pretty, I'll deal with you really quickly. Yeah. Okay. Been here, done that. And that was it. Need to backtrack a little bit. Well, the Vegan as a duelist is kind of important for me, since he does have the equipment that's the same type, things like that. As a crafting master, he'll allow me to equip to upgrade my weapons, which is pretty useful, since I actually use weapons on this character. I mean, on casters, you don't really care about weapons. They're just a means to an end to help you cast better, cast your spells better. But for someone who uses a weapon, being able to properly upgrade your weapons with percentage damage or just fixed amount of damage, especially if you find a pretty good rare, it is nice to be able to finish the crafting on that. And the Warden. Corrupted Amulet. Interesting. That's almost like a talisman. I believe there's now a divination card that grants you talismans, don't they? Haven't seen them in a while yet, but a couple patches ago they released a bunch. Let's see, just get some more mobs in here, just make them explode. Yeah, but now if you notice from just the casual way I'm interacting with things and just talking about a bunch of random things. And at this point we're so overpowered that I'm almost casually paying attention to the game, and I'm doing a lot of things on autopilot. That's probably the biggest danger in this character, especially because I'm playing on hardcore. I might just not be prepared for something that will incidentally be a lot bit more dangerous, but because I'm so relaxed, because this character is just so freaking powerful, that lapse in judgment, that moment of inattention might end up costing me the character. And that's the further we get, the higher the chance of those spikes happening, and the bigger the risk is gonna be. For now, Cruel is... First time you play through Cruel, it's pretty difficult. Once you've done it a couple times, Cruel is then no longer really that much of an issue. Cruel is Arrow, there, you wanna pay attention to him. Oh, that was Solbones, that's why it took a while to go back. But you know, we went through the entirety of normal difficulty, including Izaro and Malakai, in 12 episodes. Presumably, going through Cruel, we might do it even slightly faster. But I think we'll be hard-pressed to do it much faster. And no, by no means this is a speed race. But it is it's an indication of just the power of the build, of how fast we are going. But it does mean that we will be in Merciless rather quickly as well. And things will get more challenging and more interesting. Basically as a function of how powerful the character is to level. Okay. Well. Speaking of leveling. Okay, so Seer. I actually took quite some damage sustaining through it, but still, I took a spike. And I wasn't overly expecting it. Let's just make a quick down trip to empty our pockets and then go back. Maybe I should ID these as well. You know, weird idea. Let's ID the rares before selling them. Hey. Not really, really useful. Might as well sell it. Good, good. Thorn Rapier, that's lower level than what we currently have. Hussar Brigandine, that's quite a bit of stuff. 42. Would this be a useful candidate? Stun and Block Recovery seems a bit wasted. Could have a more useful stat. The Life Regeneration, only 3 points. That's not really worth it at this point. So the percentage increase to Armor and Evasion is nice, but that's kind of it. So we'll sell it. We'll get something better. Let's go down. Technically, we don't need to walk to the next waypoint, but no, it feels nicer to really do walk through here and actually make it out, enter the light, tag the waypoint. Because it's already blue, we don't need to tag this. You automatically get this the moment you defeat the warden. Oh, and you will enter a vile site area. Okay. This is the biggest downside of prophecies. If you enter an area and it triggers and you didn't really count or plan on playing, you still kind of have to, because otherwise you're wasting a prophecy. So a little bit of bonus content today. Because I was honestly planning to stop here after defeating the warden. And then do this bit until Mervale, doing that in the next episode. And then probably tacking on the first bit on Act 2 afterwards as well. Given how fast we're going. This way, going a bit quicker. Well, Burning Menace, that life is really not doing a lot. It's at 1 point less than max, and just flipping up and down to max, and then losing a health, and then maxing again and losing a health. There is a Piety. Okay. So we scouted out this wall. It's not here, so we need to be on the other side. Let's see. Ooh. The Immortal Call. No, it's a very nice panic save. Automatic panic save. But it's still weird to see it pop up every once in a while, because we don't really take all that much damage, so it doesn't trigger all that much. And that's my own wolf. Let's not attack our my own wolf. Okay, just double check that it's not near the beginning. It would be awkward. Okay, no vile site areas near the entrance. Okay, let's move on then. Okay, we could go in two ways. Let's hope it's the right way. So two things can happen. Either we're really lucky and we will just find where we need to be while we are going through. Ooh, orb of fusing. The reflection is starting. That's also interesting. See how we deal with reflection, because we do a pretty scary amount of damage. So reflection might actually become a relevant thing to pay attention to. On the other hand, as long as it's just a single rare that's reflecting and there's a ton of trash mobs around, I don't think we have to worry all that much. Because we will just make it up with leeching. And I don't think we'll ever do enough damage with a single hit to just insta-kill on the reflection, so that the leech doesn't have time to kick in. That's one of the nice things about Lacerate. It's inherently, it's two attacks that follow each other, so the damage is already spread out a little bit, and the game obviously is balanced for that as well. So that's the exit. Let's see if we are lucky with the waypoint. Sometimes it's just out here. You know what? Maybe we should just complete the entire story part of Act 1 in a single go. Make it... So if we're going to make it a slightly longer bonus episode, might as well do that. So there's the vault area. At least we tagged the waypoint. We go back here. Okay, jump up. And then we trace the outline back here. Yeah. This is just a complete path that just goes off all by itself. In order to lead to the Vaal area. Ah, Guardian of the Mount is here as well. It's funny, because he was walking, it almost looked like he came out of the corrupted area, which is a nice happenstance. And a prophecy completed, so that's good. I believe I had another prophecy tied to corrupted side areas. Monsters have more life. Sure, that's the least exciting of mods that it can have. I think there will be an extra reward or something. Ooh, mirrored items and guarded by Rogue Exile. Thenemoga. Vengeance is mine. Put that one over there. We can put this one here. Let's pick up that one. Oh, don't even have space for that. Wow. Let's not get any more nice items, otherwise I'll have to make a town stop. Or just feel bad because I'm leaving items behind. So. These are usually tough buggers, and giving them 10% extra life just makes them a bit more tough. Wonder if we're gonna get the cloaky snake boss, because there's just so many snakes here. Or if that's just a happenstance. Hello, there comes. Ah, we got the Guardian of the Mount. Dude. Shiak, the Maker of Floods. Who is completely dead. Oh. Ah, he drops a Vaal Orb. That was the prophecy. And... what? We actually have some space. Let's do it like that, so we can pick up the mask, we can pick up the helm. And then we have space for a sacrifice at noon. And then we can go back and portal to town to empty our pockets, because we really have to. And then we can waypoint back to where we were before. All the stuff that you pick up just on a simple run. Let's see, I said something to the tune of let's continue. I mean, there's only one more area, might as well do it, right? This is almost racing. I am stopping to smell roses, do optional side content, things like that, but... No, it's currently, we're about less than 35 minutes into the episode. And we're already here, so oh, maybe another 5 minutes. Let me finish it. Just goes to show, if you have a proper build that's working, and if you have a general idea of where you need to go, in what order, in order to complete the game, you can make pretty good progress. Also, Whirling Blades as a travel skill really helps. Caverns of Wrath. So I think all the optional side areas are now open as side quests. So that's going to be a lot of extra skill points that I can collect in between episodes. All the good stuff. Well, as I've already said before, now currently we are going for a bloodless. Next target's gonna be hematophagy for just more leech, just more sustaining. I think it might be, it would be a good idea. Tormented thug. Also, give me that boots. What? Ah, so. There's a small difference in heights. Yo. Too late. Yeah. Items, they are my weakness. And technically, I know going after a ghost is more important than picking up items, because the item will always be there and the ghost is gonna disappear, but. Yeah, shiny. Can't resist. Nah, but right now I just want to get through Cruel as fast as possible. And also in the process see how fast we can get through Cruel. In a, well, safe and responsible manner. Yeah, let's add that as a disclaimer. That sounds wise and responsible. Combination of multiple movement skills, whirling blades in those narrow corridors is annoying. Leap slam just works. Slightly slower, but it is effective if you need to move over small inefficiencies in the terrain. Well, but jumping through walls still does work with leap slam. Let's see. Bit of luck, we'll still encounter one of our daughters, so it's nice to kill a couple of uniques on the way to your destination. Furichi! Well, not really what I'm looking for, but hey. Okay, so you're sending me back. Oh, that's literally there. Assassinate the target, keep one guard alive. Sure. Who's the target? So I'm just gonna ignore the others. Yo. We got him! Haha! And then we can kill the other ones. Because that's how it works. First you kill, you fulfill the objective, and then you kill everybody anyway. Oh, but that's one of the fastest way I've gotten Verici XP yet. So that's good. Oh, dead end. Ooh. Let's be on the other side. Ah yeah, all that glitters leads to Mervale. Marvel's lair. Hello, lady. How are you today? Here. Let's totem. Push. Oi. That's not nice. I have to work for my XP. Okay. That's just part one. Put up a totem again. Part two. Oh, for the fun of it, let's use our flask to get us 40% extra damage. Prevail, please stand still. Just yes, good. Okay, that was Marvel. Yeah, I can't really do much more than just shrug. It's normal Cruel. It's not really challenging. Okay, so you will destroy the feral lord's animals. I shouldn't have gone here, but prophecies. Ah, so yeah, we will destroy the feral lord's animals, and we're gonna go to town. This is the episodes that just keep on going. It's the gift that keeps on giving. So this is the downside of just rolling prophecies. Add more prophecies, send more prophecies. Okay, here, it's need more intelligence for Enfeeble. That's, yep, very understandable, since we're not really all that good on intelligence. Being a strength dex kind of character. got a suspicion that all those glowy spider things aren't just blues, they are the Feral Lord's animals. Okay, just zigging and zagging and through here. Good, good, good. Final note, bloodless. 1600 life, and enemies can no longer leech life from us. So that's good. I don't recall any monster types that consciously leech life. But I suppose it's good that nothing can unleash anymore. I wonder if that's there just for PvP or for roleplaying purposes. Most of the time monsters just die fast enough that you don't really notice if they have any form of sustain at all. Let alone life leech. More apes. So I believe this is not a full clear level, this is just clear the special monsters. And last time I did it, I had all the way into the beginning, there was a secret area or an extra area that you had to backtrack a little bit for that I overlooked. This time I made sure not to do that. Yeah, easy echo of the verdant. Those are indeed the special mobs. So far we have killed all of those. Pretty certain of that. But the regular apes, we don't really have to care about those. That's a good thing. Because they have a habit of just turning up everywhere. Yep. Just some regular apes. Oh, more blues. There's some yellow next to me. It was time again for one of the immortal cool things to trigger. And it only triggers once every 500 points of damage. So I'm pretty surprised it doesn't trigger all that often. And that was that. Good. We're done. Oh, we are done. Yay, forest encampment. That's the one area where prophecies will not trigger. So that's good. So here I'm truly gonna call this an end. Thank you very much for watching. And I'll see you again next time when we do not clear Act 2 in a single episode. I hope, I think. It's gonna be at least 2. See you next time. Bye bye.